Today it is confirmed that the Labor Party that desperately wants a national Indigenous voice entrenched in the Constitution, if it doesn't get up, won't legislate one. And the Liberal Party, well, they oppose a national voice in the Constitution, but they say they will legislate lots and lots of regional and local voices. A constitutionally entrenched national voice is right, says Labor, because that's what Aboriginal people want. While local and regional voices are right, say the Libs, supposedly, because they would somehow avoid creating a new bureaucracy in Canberra. Meanwhile, prominent No campaigner Warren Mundine says he's against the voice, but he's in favour of treaties. And the most prominent Yes campaigner, Anthony Albanese himself, insists that the voice has nothing to do with treaties, even though the voice, treaty and truth has been the activist's mantra all along. Mind you, as I showed you here last night, courtesy of Neil Mitchell, Albanese hasn't even read all of the Uluru Statement. I mean, he's read the cover, but not the contents, despite signing up his government to implement it in full.
They know the Uluru Statement from the heart is one page, not hundreds of pages.
But what are the other 25 pages? I've read them. What are they?
What they are is a record of meetings, some of them. They're records of the big lead-up that happened.
Do you agree with most of what is said in those 25 pages?
I haven't read it.
You haven't read it?
There's 120 pages. Why would I? I know what the conclusion is.
You know, the crazy thing about all of this is that if the referendum had just been about recognition, a simple acknowledgement somewhere in the Constitution that Aboriginal people were here first and not an activist power grab via the voice, well, it would have been carried by acclamation, as in 1967, because Australia's two most prominent Conservatives, Tony Abbott and John Howard, both went to elections committed to Indigenous recognition. Both two now say they would support it if it was on the table. But both strongly reject an Indigenous power grab, and that's sadly what the voice is about. It's not about recognising First Australians. The voice issue is already a source of bitter conflict, with worse still likely to come as the Yes campaign inevitably steps up its claim that somehow it's racist to vote no. Now, most of the bile comes from the Yes camp. I mean, just listen to the latest barrage of abuse thrown at Indigenous Shadow Minister Jacinta Price.
And we have a far-right politician in Senator Napanjipa Price out there spreading lies, spreading mist and disinformation. I don't think I've come across anyone that hates Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander or seems to hate Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people so much.
I might add there, Marcus Stewart, because people asked me this last night, Marcus Stewart says he is an Indigenous man. Now, my fundamental objection to the voice is that it's wrong to give some people a special say over how we're all governed based on ancestry. As Tony Abbott has said, it's wrong in principle. He says it would be wrong and bad in practice. But if you want confirmation of just how dangerous this could be, if it comes about, look at what's happening even now in a bid to get it across the line. Big tech has been blocking voice posts that don't pass its political correctness test, first from the IPA, the Institute of Public Affairs, then from Advance Australia, and now from Sky News, from me. An editorial of mine reminding voters that the Uluru Statement from the Heart is really 26 pages, not the one the PM says it is. Well, that's now been blocked, even though the people who helped write the full statement, the 26 pages, they've been saying for many, many years, it's more than just one. Here's how my editorial now appears on Facebook. And it's all on the say-so of these so-called fact-checkers from RMIT University and the ABC. While RMIT hasn't taken an official position on the voice, it has failed to take its own advice to be well-informed on the voice in neglecting to mention all the times Uluru Statement architects have insisted it's 18-plus pages. And they've both been doing it, Pat Anderson and Megan Davis, for well over 6 years. Now, somehow, those 6 years of comments get disregarded because of a backtrack last week to save face for the PM. Well, as for the ABC too, I mean, it hardly can claim to be unbiased and impartial on The Voice. Now, seriously, I hope Australians can see through this. If The Voice gets up, we'll lose our right to constitutional equality. And on the way there, it seems, our right to free speech as well.